All right, let's talk about one of my favorite things in the engine building world, and that is cylinder head porting and just airflow theories. I'm not going to get too in-depth with it. I just wanted to show you guys this 4G head I'm working on, talk a little bit about the port work I'm doing, and show you some of the tools I'm using to do that. So if you're doing stuff from your house, you can get a better understanding of what the goals are and the tools to get you there. Check it out. All right, so this is a 4G head. This thing isn't anything crazy. It doesn't have a specific application yet, as this was a core that we had purchased. I'm doing it just to flip and sell kind of thing. So nothing too crazy port work wise. It's getting just a stock valve, and it'll have a Kegley Street spring set up for it when we're done with it here. So I have ported the one cylinder's worth of stuff here. Just kind of wanted to talk to you a little bit about my thought processes here and how we apply it. First thing, probably the most important, is how important is port work really? And that conversation gets pretty in depth, but basically the long and short of it is it's very application dependent. In a turbocharged vehicle such as this 4G63 Mitsubishi engine, I strongly feel that the turbocharger is 90% of the time the restriction in the airflow system. The cylinder head isn't a problem. So that being said, I will always port cylinder heads. I'm not gonna leave any potential horsepower on the table, even if I don't know for sure if it's gonna make a huge difference. It does not matter to me. If there's potential to make power there, we're gonna exploit that the best we can, right? So kind of keep that in mind if you're doing some results searching kind of deal. Oftentimes the turbine wheel is the flow limiter of the complete system, so kind of keep that thought process in mind. But so on to my port work stuff. I do things a little bit odd. I know to the majority of people, I prefer to do the valve job first, so these seats are already cut. I do that just so I know where the inlet angle is going to end up. Now I could always port the head first, do the valve job, and then come back to change anything that I'd like, but I've just always done it this way, and that's how I'm going to continue to do it. So a couple things too on the 4G stuff. I'm not trying to reinvent the whole wheel here. You know, I'm not trying to do anything crazy on the majority of these cylinder heads we do. I'm just trying to correct the core shift. I want each of these cylinders to flow as close to the same as possible. And the core shift out of the box can be pretty severe. This head specifically isn't that bad, but some of them I've seen are really bad. So I'm just trying to correct the core shift by doing the port work. So I'm fixing the short side radius. What to look for, a lot of that is basically you just want every runner to be as close to the same as you can. Now, I don't do these on a bench, I just feel them out by hand, but a good example of the core shift on this cylinder head would be, you know, this head, like I said, is pretty good, so I'm having a hard time picking anything serious out. But for example, on a cylinder head you're looking at, a couple things. How this is milled, this pocket's cut from the factory. Where it cuts more, you can see this one cut more here. This head here is core shifted a little bit, like outside inward, right? So this has a step here, and this part of the intake seat, and this one that I did had a step on the inside too. So the runners are kind of like this way from the outside in on both sides. The short side radius on this was okay. Short side radius meaning just this inlet, this is the profile of the runner blending into the actual intake seat itself. A lot of times there's a step, basically the seat ID and the runner ID don't match up because the runner has shifted from where the seat is. So there'll be a step in both directions. The runner will intrude into the, you know, over here, or there'll be a step where the runner is behind the edge of the seat. In that case, I will go in there with a burr and I'll smooth that airflow path out so the air isn't coming in and running into a ledge on the back side of the seat. But, you know, my theory basically is everything within a half inch either side of the valve seat is the most crucial area of the cylinder head. Cross-sectional area, that kind of stuff is very important for a max effort deal. But being that I do a lot of OE style cylinder heads, just focusing on the seat, the chamber, the short side radius area is where the net of the gains are going to be, or the majority of the gains are going to be. Couple other things to keep in mind too, if you're going to go a little bit more max effort, is, you know, your throat size to the valve size there, like what percentage the throat size is of the total valve size. That's a crucial thing we've found over the years. These 4G heads, we do a bunch of them. We've got these, something simple like this, again, being that the turbocharger is going to be the primary air pump in the system. You know, just correcting the short side radius, making sure all these are as close to the same flowing as possible is really gonna net us, you know, the best gains we can expect. This cylinder head, even in that form, would still flow enough air to support well over 1,000 wheel. So the, you know, more than what the majority of combinations are gonna make out there now. One thing you won't ever see us doing is changing the port opening size on the 4G head specifically. Again, a lot of this info is application specific, right? But the exhaust port opening on these is already too big. So some people will open them up, or I've seen some that are like a D where they just open the top and square the floor. This all overkill for these things. The runner just gets worse. You're just hurting it. And again, the exhaust, the turbine wheel, the turbocharger, 90% of the time being the system's flow restriction, it's really not super crucial on the opening diameter, the cross-sectional area. That runner isn't as crucial as you would think. Yeah, I guess that's pretty much it for this thing. A couple things to keep in mind too is just the edges on the chamber. A lot of guys actually do short side work and they'll clean the short side radius up, which very crucial for sure. But the chamber side is also important. I mean, check that step out that these things have. And then look at how I've pulled that step out of there just by hand, right? But doing that is a crucial part of the cylinder head as well. Plus, you know, any ridges in there for detonation purposes are always something to consider. Also, so yeah, let's talk a little bit about the tools that I'm using to do this. I'm odd in that I use a Makita electric die grinder to do all this work. Most people would use a little pneumatic grinder. This thing's neat. It's variable speed. It makes a bunch of torque, so I can really bury into something with a burr if I need to, which means I can get in trouble in a hurry too, but definitely this is what I've always used, so I prefer them. So this, I've just got an olive shaped burr. This is actually a Head Games burr, that one they've been selling lately. He's got a couple of them. This is the smallest one. Use that, we like it, had good luck with it. These are just, I call these like little Christmas tree burrs. This one here, I use the tip of it because it's so small to get in real well in here to pull those edges, like I showed you these edges out of there by hand. So that, I use that quite a bit for chamber work. This here is something I use for, obviously it's a ferrous metal deal. So I use this for seat material removal. If I'm gonna change this part of the seat here, like I was saying, there's a step there. I'm gonna pull that out with this burr here. And then obviously finish everything off with your just 80 grit sand roll, nothing crazy there. Something that's kind of unique that I do, again, partially because I do the valve job before I do the port work. So I have these, I usually have a stock set of valves sitting around for whatever engine I'm working on at the time. And I stick them in a lathe and I cut the margin down to zero, so the valve is super thin. And what that allows me to do, I got this one sitting in here. It's flush with the chamber. Actually, it's a little bit below the chamber surface. That just protects the valve seat as I'm screwing around with a grinder, so I don't nick the seat and make more work for myself. Even if you don't do the valve job first, it's smart to do stuff like that because you don't want to have to sink the seat, you know, to get the seat to come in, and then have to worry about valve tip height and all the other issues that that's going to create with installed height, that kind of thing too. So another quick note on the exhaust side of stuff, same thing happens. You can get that step on the back side of the seat where the seat ID and the runner ID don't line up. I don't pay pretty much any attention to that on the exhaust side. Well, I shouldn't say that. I do pay attention to it, just not as much of attention because of the airflow direction. You know, the air is exiting, it's going out, it's not coming in. So the step on the back of the seat isn't a big deal, and I often feel that it's actually advantageous to have the step there from a, from a reversion point of view, because it helps prevent air from going the other direction. And obviously reversion, just uncontrolled EGR, is never gonna be beneficial in a performance environment. So that step, I feel, often has a positive effect on total power output, just for that reason alone. But yeah, like again, this is a pretty broad, basic overview. A lot of my theories, the theories that we've developed over years, I guess, we apply to several cylinder heads, you know, Coyote, LS, you know, small block forward. A lot of the older stuff requires way more work, and anything that's naturally aspirated is going to be much pickier to the cylinder head design. We do a lot of that kind of stuff as well, and they're a bit more in depth, a bit, you know, a lot more labor intensive. We talk about valve seat widths, all that kind of stuff, which I have the all custom cutters for the 4Gs that we've developed over the years as well. But this specific cylinder head being just more your street mild performance kind of deal is pretty basic. Like I said, stock diameter valves. I didn't cut the throats of the valve seat. It is a stock throat size still, which I can't remember the throat ratio off the top of my head. But yeah, that's it for this one. Hope you guys liked it. If you want to know more about the port work thought process, ask me some questions. I know I get kind of rambling on these videos, but if you're looking for specific information, please ask. I'll do my best to answer, or if it nets it, or if it needs it, I'll make another video and talk more about it. I know I can't really show you. I haven't figured out a good way with the GoPro to show you a good view of the runner. The light's a little intense there. To show you really what I'm doing for the short side radius work, but maybe this will give you kind of a view. You see the smooth transitions here. Everything's just smooth from the runner into the seat, right? Is what you're looking for. And here you can't really see it, but there's a step right on the other side of the seat. That I still need to, obviously when I do the rest of them, I'll take care of all that. So yeah, there's a pretty basic, shouldn't say pretty basic, a very basic overview of like a street, your average build 4G cylinder head, and what our theories are and how we apply that. So hope you guys liked the video and subscribe for more of these. And again, don't be afraid to ask questions. I'm happy to help.